I have been obviously praying for some time about where do we go after Advent and the things. One of the things God laid on my heart is to spend some time talking about the church. Okay? Now, I could spend time talking about ecclesiology. Now, that's the academic name for the theology of the church. And we could talk about church and what it says and this, that, and the other thing. And it would be profitable, but I'm not sure it would be particularly practical. And I question whether it would be even transformative. And as I was working through some of the different aspects, one of the things I began to realize that if you look carefully at the scripture, you will note that whenever the church is mentioned, you don't get an academic discussion. You don't get if-then clauses. You don't get reasoned arguments. You don't get that. What you get is word pictures. You get word pictures of the church to guide you. For instance, Jesus, when he makes a statement that he's going to build his church, he says, "Upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell won't prevail against it." So he's using the idea of a rock for stability. And that rock, of course, was that he was the Son of God, you know? And but a word picture. Another one, in the Revelation, John describes the church as a bride, beautifully adorned. A bride, beautifully adorned, coming down from heaven. And then, of course, probably the one that is used the most and the most prominent is the idea of the church as the body of Christ. All of those come in. What I was surprised to learn, was that in my study, I began to realize, I learned that there are probably over 100 word pictures in the New Testament used to describe the church. And this morning, I have to tell you that when I think of the church, when someone says church to you, what's the first thing you think of? And the first thing I think of is a people with good and noble hearts. That's what I think of. Let's explore this just a little bit. It's going to be a long day. Paul is writing to Titus, and he has this to say. Interesting scripture. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous of good deeds. Interesting scripture. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit because I just like it. If you get this last line here, it says he's going to purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous of good deeds. The King James says he's going to purify for himself a peculiar people, zealous of good deeds. And I can't hardly read that, but I don't think, you know, in our world, if you're zealous to do good deeds, you're just a little weird. Right? Am I not? You're just a little weird. Now, that's not a good translation of what the word means or anything, but in a fair, God is wants a church to be a people zealous of good deeds. Let's pull this scripture apart for just a little bit. In verse 2, he says that he is training us to renounce impiety and worldly possessions. Now, the first thing we need to understand about this, good living is something that you're trained to do. It's something that you learn. Now, you may know right from wrong, but doing right from wrong is something that you learn and discipline yourself and get into the habit of doing. The idea, and what we often find is that when people come to Christ, they have to learn how to do good deeds. One of the favorite testimonies that you get, and you have to smile when it happens, but a new Christian, new convert, gets up and going to give a testimony, and he says, "Well, I'll tell you, last Tuesday I got really angry, and I started swearing. And I felt so bad. But I went to the Lord, and I asked him to forgive me and to help me get over my habit of swearing." And what happens is, little by little, inch by inch, little by little, that person is trained not to swear.
Amen. That's right.
Okay? It's a process, and it's a training process. When we start talking about evangelism, is you'll hear people make the same, because I can tell you, when you think about it, here's somebody comes in from the world, they've been living for the devil, they've been living in a culture where a lot of things that we Christians are aghast at, they think is common. I mean, I want you to just think about something. We could have a young couple come in here who've been living together, and they wouldn't think a thing about it. That's what they've been taught ever since they've been in school. And it's unfortunately, it has become normal in our society for people to live together. Okay? Now, it doesn't make it right, and it certainly has its problems, but they have to learn what God has to say about things like that. I guess the next thing I would say about that, I got saved when I was 13. I'm now 66. That means I've been living for the Lord for 53 years. And I'm still learning. Okay? Folks, we find out things about ourselves. We learn things about ourselves. And rather than saying, nobody loves me, you know, if I do this, nobody loves me, everybody hates me, that's what I'm doing. Rather than doing something like that, we need to realize that when God brings us into situations where we fall, it's not for him to know. He already knows it's there. It's for our information, and it's for the purpose of training us and helping us to get better.
Amen.
Okay? I get so tired of people being judgmental when people fail. Folks, we sang this morning, and I believe it. 'Tis not in the church of Jesus that people yet live in sin. This idea of just sin you will, sin you must, sin you can't help it, I don't buy that. Christ came to save us. But by that same token, every one of us are a work in progress.
Right.
One of my favorite songs is "He's Still Working on Me."
Amen.
There really ought to be a sign upon my heart. Don't judge me yet. There's an unfinished part. But I'll be perfect just according to His plan, fashioned by the Master's loving hand. He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. It took Him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth and Jupiter and Mars. But I'll be perfect just according to His plan, fashioned by the Master's loving hand.
Amen.
Amen.
And so one of the things we find about this is that we need to realize there is a training, there is a process. And especially when we're early on our walk with Christ, there's going to be times that we have to get up, ask the Lord to forgive us, ask the people that we've hurt to forgive us, dust our knees off, and try it again. Now notice that we're trained to announce impiety. The King James calls it ungodliness. Impiety means a lack of reverence for God. I want you to think about our world. We're taught to pray in the Lord's Prayer, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." But if you listen to our world, OMG is all over the place. And we say, "Oh, God." And of course, in movies and TV and whatever, GD and JC and all of those filthy things are just forever around. There is no reverence for God.
Right.
Unfortunately, we're living in a society, and I can tell you, I was taught it in my English classes when I was in high school, that swear words are and things like that are just words, and they are words of exclamation, and they don't mean anything, and blah, blah, blah. That's baloney. That's coming from the pits of hell. And so the idea is that we live with a reverence for God, a reverence for life, a reverence for the people around us. We renounce impiety. We're taught to do that. Also, we're trained to announce, wow, we're getting out here, worldly passions. Now, worldly passions, simplified, is money, sex, and power. You want to talk about the world, talk about money, sex, and power. It's all there. And you say, well, there might be some other things. Yeah, but those are the biggies, and those are the ones that are there. And worldly passions are about money, sex, and power. And if you talk about, or you go to our world, I don't know about you, but in a way, I believe that retail sales were down this Christmas, right? Retail sales were down this Christmas. You know what my reaction to that is? Thank God! Why are you saying that, Pastor John? Those people have worked so hard at turning Christmas into a time of spending money so that they get more money, and the only thing that they really want to do is separate you and me from our money. They're greedy. That's a worldly spirit. Right? Sex, That really doesn't even bear comment. Just turn on the TV. You can't sell a pair of sunglasses without a half-nude man and woman talking about you're going to be sexier if you wear these sunglasses. They have, it has been said that women will never be equal with men until they can walk down the street with a bald head and a beer gut and still think they're sexy. But that's our world. That's our world. And of course, power. Unfortunately, power has made its way into the church. And some of us have had to deal in churches where just big power plays and just working off a very worldly way that the church behaves. Okay? So, we've been trained to renounce worldly passions. Now, we've not only trained to renounce some things, but we've also been trained to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly. Self-control. When we start talking about self-control, we're talking about you control yourself so that you will not be controlled by anything or anyone else. Self-control. The best example I can think of is where Craig works. Here are some people who refuse to control themselves. They did whatever their impulses led them to do. They stole. They battered people. They molested people. They did all sorts of things that their impulses told them to do. And since they will not control themselves, they are in a jail, locked up, and men with guns stand around them and control them. I want you to think about something. That's the extreme example. But how many people are controlled by alcohol? Remember when Dad was drinking? Alcohol told him when to get up, when to go to work, when to come home, where to spend his money. Dad wasn't self-controlled. He was controlled by alcohol. Some people are controlled by their temper. There's no self-control there. Things don't go the way they want, and kaboom. Okay? And we are taught as Christians, and whatever, we're taught to control ourselves so that we will not be controlled by anything or anyone else except Christ. That's a tall order. But I can tell you that too often what happens is we have a bunch of adolescent 40, 50, and 60-year-old people who refuse to control themselves and live on their impulses like they did when they were teenagers. I call them adolescent. Some of them claim to be Christians. I call them adolescent Christians. They still belong in the youth group. The purpose of child rearing is this. It's to teach our children to control themselves so that as they grow and as they mature, the parents have got to exert a lot of control when they're young. For one, they are ignorant. Two, they are just dealing with their emotions as they go. But parents form a control around them. But as the child grows and as they exhibit self-control, there is a drop in parental control. And the goal being that when they reach about 15 or 16 years old, they control themselves. And parents can trust them because they are self-controlled. It's a process. And I will tell you, some people are not taught that growing up. And the problem that they have is once they become an adult, especially as they come to Christ, now all of a sudden here they are confronted with, here's Jesus calling them to self-control, and it is so foreign to them, they don't know what to do. Okay? And it's very hard for them. Oh, it can be done, and they do it, and I've seen some wonderful, wonderful victories come out of that. But we have to understand that there is a process of being trained to control yourself. Control yourself. That's kind of a statement of the obvious, isn't it? Our world's impulsive. Yeah? Amen. Our world's impulsive. That's kind of an understatement. But what we need to realize is that we are different than the world. We live in self-control. The second thing we're learn to do is to be upright and godly. Now, those are catch-all terms. What's it mean to be upright? Well, it means to be honest and true and truthful and good and kind and all those upright things that you do. And you learn to do those characters and characteristics of those virtues. I like the King James because there's just a nice rhythm to it. He says that we are taught to live soberly, righteously, and godly. That I like just the rhythm of that. Soberly, righteously, and godly. Now, when we get to verse 14, he says he gave himself for us for two reasons. First of all, that he might redeem us from iniquity. Like it or not, all of us have sinned. All of us have stains. We sold ourselves into sin. We have lived bad lives. And we've gotten in the habit of living bad lives. And Christ died on a cross so that he could buy us back and give us victory over that. When you start using the term redeem and buying back, it means to buy back. It's like you take your guitar to the pawn shop, and you get the money you got, and finally you get enough to get it back, and you go back to the pawn shop, and you give them money, and you redeem your guitar, and you get it back. Well, we were created for God. We belong to God. We are God's property. But the truth is, we're a fallen race. And we sold ourselves into sin. But Jesus Christ paid the price to buy us back and to redeem us so that we could be His and not the devil's. Amen. Not tough. It's just that simple. I'm thinking, do you remember back when we were kids, green stamps? Remember green stamps? Everybody saved green stamps. I remember Mom having books and books of green stamps. And she'd get a bunch of them together, and then she'd redeem them for something. After she got it, usually it was a piece of junk. But you would redeem those stamps. Okay? And that's what Christ did for us. What it means is, He redeemed us so that we would stop the sin business. Now, I think that it is time that we quit making excuses for sin. Now, I live in a real world. I am a real human being. I have my own demons that I must deal with. Okay? But we have come to a point in American society and even in holiness churches where we don't think it's possible to live free from sin. If you don't think it's possible, you won't try. Well, I can tell the people that grew up in Pilgrim Holiness right now. No, the truth is this. Okay, so maybe once every now and again, you may slip. But you correct it right then, you turn it around, and you don't do it again. That's one thing. It's another thing to say, well, you know, that bad temper of mine is just me. No, it's not just you. It's the devil. Did I just say that? But you see, he redeemed us so that we would stop the sin business. The other thing he wanted to do was purify for himself a people of his own. Of his own. Now, at this point, we need to talk about church. The Greek word translated church in English is ekklesia. It means to be called out from the general population. Now, how it was originally developed and used was in the Greek city-states, where they had a pure democracy and every citizen was involved in the government of the city-state. The citizens were called out of the general population to handle the government affairs of the city-state. Now, what you have to remember is, in order to be a citizen, A, you had to be a male. B, over half of the population were slaves. C, half of those other people were women. And so, here is a group of people who were called out of that general population to handle the affairs of government. Well, as time came on and things evolved, the idea of ecclesia came to talk about really any group that was called out of the general population. And so here is Paul talking to Titus and saying to him that Christ died to purify for himself a people of his own. We're called out of the general population. We're bought with a price. We're not our own. We belong to Christ. And we're part of that select group of people that Jesus went by and said, I want you, and 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 I want you. Would you be my people? Now think about that. The God of heaven died on a cross and selected you to be a people of his own.